Good morning. I'm Jim Carefoot with Armada Technologies, and welcome to Armada's Find It, Fix It Friday webinar. Today we're going to talk about doing a quick health check on a conventional irrigation system while standing at the controller clock with the unit open without going into the field. This is a pretty useful thing to do if you're new to a system, first time look, or if you're doing a rehab in the spring. Very kind of simple thing can use simple tools for. Our goal today is to show you how to use an electrical tool or two to identify problems from the system end without leaving the controller site. This is a good quick way of figuring out what your status is. The three things we do when we're at the controller, is the controller working? You can look at voltages and other system indications on the panel to find out if it's working. You can look at the zone wiring that comes back from the field, appears at the controller. You look at those things, and finally, you can actually try to operate some valves right from the controller. These are good, quick things you can do to find out what the health of the system is. I always say, write stuff down. What I'm showing here is a little information diagram sheet that I have used before. It gives me an opportunity to write down what I found, where it was, what the location of the controller was, how many zones, anything else I know about it, especially if I chase down some valve locations and I know the identity of the zones and their purposes. So good thing to write down. You can fold this up, stick it back inside the box, or keep it with your records. So once you go through this, it's a great thing to have written down because you will not remember if you're anything like me. The controller is the heart of an irrigation system. This is why we do this test here, because it stands between the power source and the remotely operated valves in the field and applies power to them, closing them, releasing water to the zones based on the program we give it. Because it does all these things, we can find power, control functions, and wiring all in the same place. Very conveniently located typically inside the face of the box. This diagram just illustrates a conventional irrigation system. We have one common wire running to every one of the remotely operated valves and one zone wire to each of the valves. The multi-wire controller then just applies 24 volts AC to the zone wires and to the common wire and causes the valve solenoid to pull in and release water to the zone. This is why we call it a multi-wire controller, of course, because there's a wire per zone. What do you need to do this? All you need is an inexpensive electrical multimeter. You may have one around, you may have a fancy one, you may have a simple one. Any of those will work for doing this trick. You can also use a system multi-tester like our Pro48. The Pro48 does kind of 4-in-1 tests, including operating a valve remotely that you can do without using the controller. Either one of these, the meter or the 4-in-1 tester, will work to do a health check on the system from in front of the clock. And a screwdriver, I should mention, is another thing you got to have. A little tip on the lower left, checking power outlets. It's a great thing to have, a little sub-$10 power cube, I call it. It's a thing you plug into an outlet, gives you an indication if the power's on and if it's wired correctly. A good tip off if you've popped a breaker somewhere. The kind of meter you might need, as I said, the cheapest thing you can find is typically going to work in this health check application. It can be one of our nice full auto digital clamp meters. It can be a Harbor Freight special like the one I show in the middle there with a needle manual analog kind of a meter. Or it can be a manual digital meter like our Pro 30. Very simple kind of things. Just to illustrate, this little cheat card that we give out to go with Pro 30s shows you the things that you need to do for this kind of a check and, in fact, are possible using this Pro 30. Check a clock output, check a solenoid condition in ohms, check a power outlet to find out if it's got 120 volts in it, even checking fuses. So simple functions, simple meter, all the way from Harbor Freight to something pretty special. Any one of those will work. Electrical multimeters are the all-around tool when you work with this thing. Hopefully you have one of those somewhere in your vehicle or in your toolbox, and it can be used to do a lot of different things. We're working with voltages here that are not hazardous, except for 120 volts. I have to say, the voltages coming out of the outlet is always something to be respected and be careful. If you put any probes into a power outlet, that you keep your fingers away from the metal. Rest of the system voltages are 24 volts AC, currents less than half an amp, and fairly low resistances, not something to be concerned about if you're going to touch them or be afraid that you're going to arc over something. So what we're doing up at the controller, we've got the thing open, we've got the panels open so we can see it. We're going to verify, number one, that the clock and controller are working. The front panel LCD should be on. You should have voltage coming into it. You can check for wire faults, number two, from the controller. And number three, it's possible to operate zones from this controller, either using the controller or using the 4-in-1 irrigation system tester. What we're looking for out in the fields most commonly are wire damage, field wire issues, bad splices, crushed wires, cut wires, skinned wires, things that have wires. By that I mean wires that have had a post driven right along them and took the insulation off the outside, or a gopher's chewed the insulation, all the way down to the open solenoids, bad solenoids that you have to kind of troubleshoot by going out to the valve. But you can see these things from up at the controller. This little troubleshooting diagram I have here is one that we use for the whole system troubleshooting webinar and course that we do. And in yellow, I've highlighted the things that we do just from standing at the controller, the things that you can do without having to go into the field and start looking for wires and boxes, checking voltage, disconnecting station wires, checking resistances on wires, those sorts of things. So you can see that at least half this process involves stuff you just do at the controller. At the controller, the things you find, good news would be there on the left column, bad news on the right. The left column, you have 120 volts AC going to the controller. You have 24 volts AC going into the controller. You can often find this on terminals inside to check it. And when you select a station to activate it, you get 24 volts AC on the station wire terminal. These are things that you'd like to have happen. If you look down the wires with a meter after you've shut the controller off, look down the wires, if you see between 20 and 80 ohms of resistance going out there, you are in good shape. If you have more than 100,000 ohms of resistance in between any of the wires and ground, you're also in good shape. And you can fire the valve using the valve activator, the Pro48. Bad things would be if there's no way 24 volts AC when you try to activate the station. Make sure you know how to run the station correctly and that you have don't have the rain sensor turned on and not connected. Station to common wire, less than 15 ohms would be a short circuit and a red light on the Pro 48 if you're using that. A red light will get you an open indication if the station is more than 200 ohms, probably meaning a cut wire. I'm going to show a little video here that shows how that Pro 48 works. It illustrates the different kinds of tests that you can do with it. So I'm going to switch over to that right now.
The Pro 48 is designed to test several features on your clock. First, it will test whether the clock is outputting 24 volt AC. It will also test whether the wires are short or open to the solenoid or valve. In addition, it will send tracing tone and activate and hold open a solenoid or chatter that solenoid for locating purposes. The Pro 48 is powered by two 9-volt batteries found in the back of the unit. These are not included with the unit, and you will need to install
Okay, I hope you were able to hear that okay and see the video. There may have been a little bit of jerkiness in the video because of the internet, but it gives you an illustration of what you can do with the Pro 48, very similar to what you can do with a meter. The difference with the Pro 48 is, of course, you can activate the solenoid from up at the controller, which causes the valve to open and water to come on if you have the water open. Good way of identifying which zones are which physically by seeing which area the sprinklers come in. So, again, we've picked the access at the controller because we can see the terminals and all the things we want to test typically by just removing the front panel of the controller. The little video indicated using the backside of a circuit board. You don't normally have to do that. You can see all of the things you need to see at the front of the controller. A little row of screw terminals in the case of this one that's illustrated here. You can check the 24 volts coming in from the main power source. You can look at the condition of a rain sensor if it's in use. You can access all the screw terminals for checking the zone wires and commons. So if we're doing our checking, issues related to the controller, if we don't find 120 volts, we've probably got a pop circuit breaker somewhere. You can use your little AC voltage cube or your meter to check that, or just find a circuit breaker and make sure that the GFCI isn't popped on it from some earlier event and it's causing the controller not to work. If you don't have any main 24-volt AC coming from the power unit that's going to this thing, it may still be that pop fuse or a breaker. You might have, some of these units have fuses in them, and you can check for a pop fuse using your meter or by just observing it. If there's no 24 volts at the station, you may have a bad module in the station, in the controller. You could have a rain sensor that's not connected and turned on. That can inhibit the operation of the controllers, too. If you find an open or a high resistance going out to the field, you probably have some cut wires or bad splices. This bad splices are a very common thing to have happen, especially if good waterproof splice has not been used to attach the station wires to the valve solenoids. But it can be a cut. Cuts occur sometimes, for instance, over the winter when you're bringing a system up. Something's happened. Somebody's used a shovel or driven a stake in the ground and cut the wires. If you get a good test on the valve, but the valve doesn't close, you could have skinned wires where corrosion has come in and power is being leaked into the earth instead of closing the solenoid. So that's less common. If you get a short circuit, you may have some crushed wires somewhere and bad wire splices that are underwater. You could even have a bad solenoid. So those are all typical things that you see with those kinds of conditions. Also, if you're getting an open indication, the bad wire splice may be down at the valve box. It could be at an intermediate point or something, but it can be at the valve box, so eventually you'll have to go and have a look at it if that's what it shows. But all you're really trying to do is go through here, make sure the controller is working, and station by station, check the field wire for good and bad conditions, and make a note of it on your sheet. We just showed you how to use the Pro 48 to do these tests, but you can also see more detail on how to use a meter to do them. We have some short videos on using a meter on the Facebook page, or not the Facebook page, the YouTube page. So you're invited to go down there. I'll show you in a minute what the website address is for that. And you can observe these very short videos on what to do with a meter. So in summary, you can use a simple meter or tester to spot trouble from the clock. You walk to the clock, open it up, expose the panels, do our 1-2-3 test, make a list of which zones are okay and not okay, and you'll have a good run on an idea what's going on with the health of the system, and it won't take long. Next week, we are going to be doing a webinar on using the automatic electrical clamp meter. You'll see that in our videos. You'll also see it in different other illustrations that we use. Very nice little clamp meter that is commonly available through our distributors, and we're going to show you a little bit about how it works and how to make use of it. The following week after that, we're going to repeat our troubleshooting multi-wire versus two-wire irrigation system, the differences in the tools and techniques that you have to do those. We have over 20 demos and training videos at our YouTube channel, and you can find that by going to YouTube and searching for ArmadaTech, or you can go to youtube.com/user/ArmadaTech and see a listing of all of those. And we're constantly updating and adding them. That Pro 48 demo you saw earlier is also available in Spanish, for example. You can see that on the YouTube page. Here are some resources related to us. Our main website, ArmadaTech.com. You can find some training videos there, but you can find data sheets and other information on products. The YouTube channel has a number of training videos and illustrations. We have a Facebook page to make it a little easier to find us. A lot of folks know how to use that. We have an ArmadaTech blog called ArmadaUpdate.wordpress.com, where I post invitations to the webinars, data sheets, application notes, the little reference card for the meter. All those things are at the blog, ArmadaUpdate.wordpress.com. And I'm Jim Carefoot. I'm available at jcarefoot@armadatech.com. So drop me an email if you have any questions. You want to see us cover some different topics, you'd be welcome to. Some of these topics were requests from users of the equipment in the first place. So thanks for joining us today, and I hope you have joined us at a future webinar. Thank you.